Good morning. This is the Clay Terrace Bible Study, or as we like to say sometimes, it's the Revelation Bible Study right now. We're in, I think, week 18 as we proceed into Revelation, this book, not just about the end times, but about how we can live every single day looking forward to that great culmination of our faith of being with Christ, of being with each other on the new heaven and new earth. So, this morning, by the way, any of you could join us at 8 o'clock on Friday morning, Eastern time. The details for doing that are at clayterrace.org, clayterrace.org. And of course we post the, video recording, at indychristian.tv. You could also pick up that link at clayterrace.org. So, good morning. We'll have different, folks in the room, but Pastor Andy Hunt from New Life Community Church at 86th and Ditch here in Indianapolis will be at least leading the discussion as we review the first three chapters that we've covered so far. So I think, Tunji, you volunteered to pray us in, brother.
Yeah, let's do it. Dear Father, we just want to first thank you and give honor to your name. Father, we thank you because you rose us up this morning with a reasonable portion of our health and intellect. Father, you put in our hearts the desire to gather together to study your word. Father, we know that all good things come from you, and even the good things that we do are motivated by your spirit, Father. Independent of you, we cannot do anything. I thank you for Pastor Andy laboring in your word so that he can instruct us, so that we can learn and grow together, Father. As always, I pray that these words are not just for intellectual value. It's not just to puff us up so that we can pretend to know something and pretend to be self-righteous or self-wise, but it's to be more fruitful. It's so that we can serve you, Father, that we can love you better, and that we can love our fellow man in a more holistic and full way, Father. I pray that our hearts are open, that our minds are clear as we study your word. We pray for so many that are still hurting on this day when we had such an immense tragedy, Father, but we know that even in that, you are sovereign. Even in that, Father, you provide healing and comfort. So let us have that in our mind, that people are still reminded of this day, and that they still hurt, and may we have an open heart for them. I pray that we are focused. I pray that we are attuned to the word in all ways. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Great. Okay, so Gina, if you'll lead off in chapter 3, just 3 or 4 verses, that'd be great.
Yes. Write this letter to the angel of the church of Sardis. This is the message from the one who has the sevenfold spirit of God and the 7 stars. I know all the things you do, and that you have a reputation for being alive, but you are dead. Wake up, strengthen what little remains, for even what is left is almost dead. I find that your actions do not meet the requirements of my God. Go back to what you heard and believed at first. Hold to it firmly. Repent and turn to me again. If you don't wake up, I will come to you suddenly, as unexpected as a thief. Yet there are some in the church of Sardis who have not soiled their clothes with evil. They will walk with me in white, for they are worthy.
Jim Komazinski, if you can read from 5.
Okay. The one who conquers will be clothed thus in white garments, and I will never blot his name out of the book of life. I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. We continue on?
Sure.
Okay. To the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, the words of the Holy One, the true One, who has the key of David, who opens and no one will shut, who shuts and no one opens. I know your works. Behold, I have set before you an open door, which no one is able to shut. I know that you have but little power, and yet you have kept my word and have not denied my name. Behold, I will make those of the synagogue of Satan who say that they are Jews and are not, but lie. Behold, I will make them come and bow down before your feet, and they will learn that I have loved you.
Since you have kept my command to endure patiently, I will also keep you from the hour of trial that is going to come on the whole world to test the inhabitants of the earth. I am coming soon. Hold on to what you have so that no one will take your crown. The one who is victorious, I will make a pillar in the temple of my God. Never again will they leave it. I will write on them the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, the New Jerusalem, which is coming down out of the heavens from my God. And I will also write on them my new name. John.
Yeah, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. And to the angel of the church in Laodicea, write the words of the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of God's creation. I know your works. You are neither cold nor hot. Would that you were either cold or hot. So because you are lukewarm and neither cold, hot or cold, I will spit you out of my mouth.
Holly, verse 17.
She's muted.
Oh, Holly, you're muted.
Okay. You say, I am rich, I have acquired wealth, and I do not need a thing. But you do not realize that you are wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, blind and, wait a minute, sorry, and naked. I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in the fire so that you can become rich, and white clothes to wear so you can cover your shameful nakedness, and salve to put on your eyes so you can see.
Let's see, verse 19, those whom I love, I rebuke and discipline, so be earnest and repent. Here I am, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with that person and they with me. Andy, you want to pick it up at 21?
The one who conquers, I will grant to him to sit with me on my throne, as also I conquered and sat down with my Father on his throne. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Praise God. We find ourselves this morning at the Church of Sardis. We see that Jesus is speaking to the seven churches of Asia Minor, and he has a pattern here. He usually commends those struggling churches before giving them a word of rebuke. Now, we need to notice something that happens here differently here at the Church of Sardis. He's not doing that. This congregation doesn't receive any commendation. What it receives is a stern rebuke. He says, wake up. Jesus warns them that if they don't wake up, he is going to come suddenly and bring judgment against them. This church thinks that it is alive, but in reality, this church is dead. This congregation is dead because they have stopped preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ, because they are more inclined, they're more concerned about making peace with paganism. And I think right now, we as a Church of Jesus Christ, we too have stopped preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. I think number one, because we think the true gospel of Jesus Christ undercuts mass evangelism. And secondly, we want to fit in and we don't want to do anything that might offend a pagan worldview. Thirdly, I think we're unable in our own power when our power is not aided by the power of the Holy Spirit, or that we just refuse the principles of faithful witness that Jesus Christ requires of us. So here Jesus is telling the church of Sardis that they are no longer considered a faithful witness. So the church must wake up, the church must repent, or the consequences, they're going to face the wrath of God, who is the Lord of his church. And as well, we who are in the Church of Jesus Christ here and now, we need to wake up and face and repent, or we will face the wrath of Jesus Christ as well. Now, we recognize that in these seven letters that went out to the churches in Asia Minor, he deals with those specific aspects of the way they give him glory and honor, and then also those things that they're struggling with, the issues that they have. And he challenges them when they're not being obedient to the world. Jesus wants to show that he is not an absentee landlord of his church. When we see Jesus here and that resurrected state that comes from Revelation 1:18, you see him here represented, walking in the midst of the seven lampstands, symbolic of Christ's presence among his church, as well as symbolic of the Holy Spirit empowering those congregations to be just what he's saying that Sardis is not, that they are to be a faithful witness before an unbelieving world. He knows their struggles. He compliments on their victories, but he wants them to represent him thoroughly, as much in his first advent as well as in his second coming. And these are issues that were faced by the first century church, and there are still issues in the 21st century church. So that's why he ends this particular passage with the same refrain: he who has ears, let him hear what the Spirit is saying to the churches. So let's dive right in here. We see a situation here facing the church of Sardis. It's unique in some ways, in some ways it's not. Sardis is about 50 miles east of Smyrna and just north of Philadelphia. These two adjoining sites give us a plural name, Sardis. The original city was developed into a huge fortress and built on a rocky point, which dominated the valley that was 1,500 feet below them. So the valley that was 15 feet below them was built on steep hills, supposedly that they could not be scaled or they could ever be attacked or dominated by invading army. So because of that, they felt incredibly safe. They were in a strategic location right outside of Lydia. It was a mercantile community, lots of merchants, thriving marketplace, and that it gave them, they had the major trade routes in that area, so they became a wealthy city. They even had fertile soil, so they became a large farming community as well. So given their economic proudness, they were able to have great influence in local politics, even with Roman rule dominating the day. This was the home of King Midas, you know, the one that was known with the golden touch, and also King Croesus, which is one of the wealthiest men in the ancient world. And he's the one that suffered the great debacle that happened when Sardis was invaded by another army that was able, it was really Cyrus, the king of Persia, that was able to come in and find men who could scale that rocky point and get into the fortified city. And because of that, he was left with this humiliating defeat, because he regarded that he was a man that didn't have much self-control, and he gave in to all of his own whims, and he thought his area was impregnable, but he found out that it wasn't. Look at the Proverbs 25, 27 through 28. This doesn't relate directly to King Croesus, but it's definitely reminiscent of that kind of attitude. Proverbs 25, 27 through 28. It is not good to eat much honey, nor is it glorious to see one's own glory. A man without self-control is like a city into a city broken into and left without walls. So any situation where we get to the point that we become self-sufficient, that we lose our self-control, then we're like a city that has been broken into and one that has no defenses, because we have no walls. We have no boundaries that have been laid out by our holy God, which we serve. So we see here, just like Croesus, King Croesus, the church in Sardis thinks they're doing fine, but in reality, they are not. They are at risk of becoming overrun by their enemies. They're ignoring the clear and present threat of paganism in their community. Look what it says here at the beginning when we look at verse 1 of chapter 3. The salutation is the same. Jesus of the angel of the church of Sardis. And then you see it's directed, he says, to write these words to him who holds the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. What is Jesus referring to here? Back to the vision of his resurrection that we see clearly in Revelation 1 and 18 that opens the chapter. He begins by rebuking this church. He wants them to know that he holds the seven spirits, the seven churches in the palm of his hand, that he is the Lord. He's all-knowing. He's without limit. He's omnipresent. He knows the true condition of each of the churches, and especially the conditions of their hearts. Sardis may think highly of themselves, but that's not as important as what Christ thinks of us. And even as the Church of Jesus Christ now, we might put ourselves on a pedestal, and what we have accomplished and what we have gained through what we consider our own works, and not recognizing that everything we have comes from above. All good things and all blessings come down from above. But he tells them here, I know your deeds. You have a reputation of being alive, but you are dead. Jesus is saying appearances can be incredibly deceiving. Despite this church's reputation, despite their wealth, despite their presumed vitality, this church is dead and not alive at all. Worse, this church is not aware of the fact that they're dead, that they're walking dead men and women. They have this grandiose overestimation of who they are. And they have gotten this reputation by self-evaluation and not being evaluated by the will and the word of Christ. And he challenges them for their deplorable condition. He gives them no commendation at all. And look how he speaks to them directly in the imperative in verse 2. Wake up, strengthen what is about to die, for I have found your deeds not complete in the sight of my God. I think it's incredibly forceful here. He's telling them to become watchful. He indicates that there's a problem with their church. He's telling them that their members have become so lethargic and indifferent to the gospel that it was as if they were asleep. that they are no longer watchful. They have fallen into the methodology of paganism, of the community that surrounds them. Is this not the same frame of reference that we can find for many of our churches today? Are we not asleep at the wheel today while the pagan society around us is moving forward us off a cliff? I dare you to look at 1 hour of regular television, just regular broadcast television, and look at the commercials and tell me if the pagan society is not driving us. Look at the images that are put before us day in and day out that have nothing to do and in no way honor God at all. So Jesus here is telling Sardis that they must strengthen that which remains that is about to die. He's speaking about their faith in Christ. He's talking about their exhortation to strengthen what remains, because he tells us further on in verse 2, I have found your deeds incomplete. That implies, I think it implies that at one time they were faithful in Christ. One time they were a faithful witness for Christ and the gospel to those people who were in the church and those people who were outside the church. But something, my friends, has happened here, which has impeded the church's progress and taken away their vitality, snuffed out the congregation's witness to those around them. Their deeds need to be resuscitated before they die completely. So what could be some of those things? We see that these Christians have not brought to fruition what Christ wanted them to do as a church. We recognize that what they have started, they have definitely not finished. We understand that they have somehow cowered down to their society around them, and they want to gain human approval. And human approval has given them the disillusionment that they are growing, that they are vital. Whether it showed up in attendance to their church, whether it showed up in the fact that they had become a wealthy community and maybe they were able to be very self-sustaining. But regardless of any of that, he also shows us that this particular church, unlike the other six, you don't see any mention of suffering and you don't see any mention of persecution for the Lordship of Jesus Christ. So it seems like they have given in completely to the world around them. Now, even though Sardis did not have some of the challenges of Thyatira or Smyrna or Pergamon when it came to pagan temples and guilds and different things that were going on, the Ephesus, that they had the Temple of Diane, they still somehow had decided to give in to a pagan worldview. They were dead instead of being alive.
Andy, just question. Since we're kind of reviewing these seven churches, and I'm just doing this off the top of my head, remembering, there were some of the seven churches that were persecuted, and they were found to be faithful, right? They were enumerated as faithful. And of course, we have quite a number of them that were not enumerated, at least on the whole, generalizing about these churches that were not particularly faithful, and they were apparently not the ones that were being persecuted. Should we draw anything from that apparent correlation? And I'm now fast forwarding to America today, and I'm wondering, how do we fit against this? Yes, we have some potentially they're walking worthy. Sardis says they're dressed in white, you know, as a symbol. And yet this church was said, oh, your reputation is being alive, right? Well, you know, immediately what picture comes to your mind about churches in America that are going, man, that's an alive church, right? So is there a generalization here that is something we should draw from on the whole?
Does that make sense? I can't think of a passage out of 1 Timothy, but all those who work to serve God faithfully will be persecuted. The persecution of the church is a trademark or a stamp of a church that is following the gospel of Jesus Christ, because the gospel of Jesus Christ will always bring a great joy, but also great suffering. It will always bring persecution when it pursues the will of God in this world. This world, this unbelieving pagan world, is juxtaposed to any of the parameters or borders that God has erected in his word. And whenever a church gets incredibly comfortable and faces, is celebrated and faces a lack of persecution, a lack of conflict, I dare you to check whether or not they're preaching the gospel. I dare you to check if their members are living in the will and in the center of God's will and in his authority. There will never be peace on this earth for a church that is pursuing its all for Christ. All those who are willing to serve God godly will face persecution. So I think he is making a correlation there that when he lifts up, because most of the times that in these letters, when they are commended, it's because they have faced suffering, they have faced persecution, they have faced poverty, but they have what? They have kept faithful in spite of. They have persevered. Yeah. I mean, I think we have to always recognize, if we want to look at the metaphor of, as the Church of Jesus Christ, we are pilgrims, or rather, I don't want to mix metaphors. We are soldiers that who are living behind enemy lines, and that we're making progress through the power of the Holy Spirit. But we recognize that we are in this world, but not of this world. And the more we live up to the standard of Christ, the more a conflict we're going to face. And I think the modern church doesn't want to face any conflict. The modern church doesn't have the character to be misunderstood or to be unpopular. And how are you going to be popular in the eyes of those who don't reverence Christ? Of course you're going to be unpopular. Of course they're going to despise what you're saying and what you're doing when they don't hold the same values that you do.
Okay, don't let me steal your thunder if you're planning on covering this, just say so. But I'm thinking, like, how does that happen? You know, that they've got some folks here in Sardis, in this case, that are walking worthy. And of course we know from not just the New Testament, but Old Testament, you know, that walking metaphor, you know, it's like, hey, it's daily. It's apparently in a straight line. It's walking in God's ways, and he becomes their God, and we become his children, right? So how do people go from walking, you know, really worthily, and yet with a church is an organized church, right? So there's an organized church at Sardis, and it had elders, presumably. I mean, that was what the apostles went out and said, hey, appoint elders and these highly qualified people, right? And deacons, appoint deacons to ensure justice. So how do you go from having these highly qualified elders and deacons to this situation in what, maybe 50 years of the advent of the church? So over that period of time, they transgressed and became some folks who were not the leaders in the church, were not the ones, quote unquote, walking worthy. How does that happen?
I think that is central to the claim against them that Christ is pursuing, is that just as you and I, as long as we maintain a healthy diet, we stay healthy as long as we are eating foods that are nutritious and that build up our body. But now this church, because they have walked away from the gospel, if they've walked away from the gospel, they're not being fed a nutritious diet anymore. And because of that, many of those who, again, you know, it's just not one-sided. When we're in the church, we need to be sitting under a ministry, or we need to be in a church that preaches and teaches the gospel, that we grow and that we edify Christ. But then we also, as Paul tells us, study to show yourselves approved, a workman rightly dividing the word, shall not be ashamed. That becomes our responsibility on those off times during devotion and Bible studies and everything else that we can engage ourselves in. We take biblical supplements to build up and our bodies against the outside world and their influences. But if we don't start off with a healthy diet in the place that we come to sup twice a week, then we're not probably going to maintain that on our own. And I think the same thing happens in the church now, that we don't take enough time of our own in private devotion. We don't take enough time of our own to study God's word. We find everything else, all the distractions that this world offers, and we take time to do those, but we're not building ourselves up in the faith of Jesus Christ, that we are able to discern what is happening. It's subtle. And I'm sure over those 50 years, even at the beginning of the church, it became easier as you were persecuted by a larger community to decide, okay, how do we find peace with these people that we can coexist? So we allow those issues from the outside world to come into the kingdom of God and start to dilute his word. Instead of holding firm to it, we say, well, maybe he really didn't mean it that way. And we continue to downplay the inerrancy of God's word. And before we know it, you know, we're about to lose our candle, our lampstand. And I think we're sitting on many churches that are, they're churches in name only. They're churches in name only. I mean, there are congregations in name only. You can congregate on a corner. But in the church, there must be two memberships. Membership to the Church of Jesus Christ, visible, and membership in the Church of Jesus Christ, invisible. That we must maintain both of those.
Of course, I'll be quick to add, you know, of these seven churches, they're all addressed as the church at a city. So they had not yet, after 50 years, they had not yet fractured into First Baptist of Sardis and Second Presbyterian of wherever. But it inevitably leads that way, I suppose, if in fact you've got some folks that are walking worthy, and somewhere or another, the elders, deacons, leaders, manage to take the congregation in a different direction. I don't know. Anyway, sorry for that interruption, but
look at verse 3 of chapter 3 here in Revelation. Remember therefore what you have received and heard, obey it and repent. So again, what is he focusing them back on? He's focusing them back on the diet, which comes in the correct teaching and preaching of his word. Remember therefore what you have received and heard, obey it and repent. He wants them to go back to doing things that they had done in the beginning. He wants these members of this church to remember the message of the gospel, which was a founding document of their churches, the message that they were posed to establish their witness, not only at their church, but just like you're saying, the church of Sardis. So they're supposed to be able to establish this message for the entire city. Okay. The city has basically recruited them instead of them recruiting the city, right? Secondly, they are to obey the gospel. Look at the John 6:29. John 6:29. Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent." They need, if they believe in whom God has sent, Jesus Christ, his son, that means they need to behave in accordance to the gospel. You said it about them walking in a certain way. That whole idea of peripateo, that lifestyle, that gospel or biblical overview or worldview that they should have concerning their lives. We should walk in a way that is so distinct from paganism that it catches people's attention. Look at Ephesians. Go to Ephesians for a minute. Go to Ephesians 4:17-24. Ephesians 4:17-24. "Now this I say and testify in the Lord, that you must no longer walk as the Gentiles do." Now here he's speaking of the Gentiles as being unsaved, okay? "No longer walk as the Gentiles do in the futility of their minds. They are darkened in their understanding, alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them. Due to their hardness of heart, they have become callous and have given themselves up to sensuality, greedy to practice every kind of impurity. But this or that is not the way you learn Christ, assuming that you have heard about him and were taught of him as the truth is in Jesus. To put off your old self, which belongs to your former manner of life and is corrupt through deceitful desires, and to be renewed in the spirit of your minds, and to put on the new self created after the likeness of God in true righteousness and holiness." They are to believe and obey the gospel. If you believe and obey the gospel, you have to reject paganism. You have to be a witness of Jesus Christ for all those people around you. They had to wake up, and we need to wake up to the precarious situation that we find ourselves in, and we need to acknowledge and confess our sinful behavior for not holding to the principles that he has given us. Otherwise, look what he says, "If you don't wake up, I will come like a thief, and you will not know what time I will come to you." Go to a interesting passage. Go to Matthew 24:40-44. Matthew 24:40-44. "Then two men will be in a field. One will be taken and one left. Two women will be grinding at the mill. One will be taken and one left. Therefore, stay awake, for you do not know on what day your Lord is coming. But know this, that if the master of the house had known in what part of the night the thief was coming, he would have stayed awake and would not have left his house to be broken into. Therefore, you must also be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect." Now, I know there are many who take this reference here as the second advent of Christ. I don't think this is what Jesus is referring to at all here. He's referring to the historic visitation of himself upon the congregation before the end of the age. It speaks about the congregation if it doesn't repent of their false estimation of themselves and realize to the degree that they have allowed themselves, which allows the church to compromise with the spirit of that age, then Jesus will bring that congregation to an end. He will remove that lampstand, just like he spoke to the church at Ephesus, and he speaks to the church at Sardis as well. But as Neil was bringing up here, there were still some faithful people in this church at Sardis. Look what he says. Yet you have a few people in Sardis who have not soiled their clothes. Now here, he's talking about the soil in their clothes as a stain of sin, that there are members of this particular church who have not given in to the pagan influences. They have not stained their garment by participating in pagan practices or sexual immorality or going to pagan feasts. They remain faithful. They did not compromise their confession of faith. And because of that, look at again what Jesus promises those who persevere in the faith. They will walk with me dressed in white, for they are worthy. He who overcomes will be like them, be dressed in white. I will never blot out his name from the book of life, but will acknowledge his name before my Father and his angels. That he will never, ever erase our name from the book of life. For me, this is incredibly reminiscent of what happens in Exodus. I think it's around the 32nd chapter. But you remember, God has led them out of bondage. And now Moses is left to go to the Mount Sinai to have a staff meeting with God. And he's been gone longer than those in the congregation would have wished for him to be gone. So now they feel like they don't know exactly what's going on. So they go to his second in command, and they want to create a God like their pagan neighbors. So they, you know, he succumbs to their request and gathers all their gold, and he melts it down and he builds them this molten calf. And then Moses is coming down from his staff meeting with the Lord, and he hears all of this noise, and he says, I hear this noise, but this is not the noise of war that I hear, but this is the noise of singing. So he finds himself approaching the camp, and they are having a worship service, worshiping this particular golden idol that they have made, stating that this is the God that brought them out of bondage. So you were talking about, you know, 50 years and seeing a church descend into a place where the gospel is no longer preached or people become unfaithful. How long was this period from God just rescued and taken them past the Red Sea, and now he's gone a couple of weeks and they want to have a pagan God and begin to worship him, and they go from worship into an orgy. That's what it means when it says, and they sit down to play. So without that constant diet of the word of God and leadership that will challenge idolatry in all of its various forms, left to our own devices, we just can't be trusted. We will always sin against the one. But and what did Moses does here? Moses does, he goes back and he asks the Lord, he pleads with the Lord that if he's going to blot them out of his book, then blot me out of your book as well. You see that there's a great mediation here, one with Christ and one with Moses, that Christ said their our names will never be blotted out of his book. And even though the state of this church is so bad and that Christ describes them as dead, there are some people who are still receiving the promise that Christ has made to them. So what do we do here? You know, whatever church, whatever denomination we belong to, we don't want to become like the Church of Sardis. We don't want to avoid the true preaching of the gospel of Jesus Christ. We don't want to see the cross of Jesus Christ as a scandal. We want to be alive and not dead. We want to recognize that we are all redeemed by the word of God that is inerrant and infallible. We don't want to ever cease preaching and teaching, fellowshipping with one another, private devotion and private study. We don't want to ever take away time away from the Lord that we could be building ourselves up on every leaning side. We want fellowship like this one here several times a week because we want to have fellowship with our family, especially since we are in a world operating behind enemy lines. So we always want to seek solace with one another, being reminded of the goodness of the Lord, even in the midst of a pandemic, even in the midst of persecution, even in the midst of outright despair, that we trust God's word and know that he is for us and he's more than the world against us. So we need to find those times. Go ahead, Nim.
So, well, just and maybe this is premature as we say, hey, it's Friday at Clay Terrace. How do we live? But, you know, in this case, those people were in the church in Sardis. And I'm wondering, like, what did that look like for those who were walking worthy? And did the other congregation members, as they observed their lifestyle and so forth, did they recognize that? And how would we do that in our American church today? And again, I realize, you know, somebody might say, well, hey, you just leave that church and you go find one that really is biblical and so forth. And I don't know, maybe that is the answer, but I'm thinking more to the point of how do you live it out within this thing that's still called the church? I mean, the Israelites, for instance, in Moses' time, no doubt, they didn't all go worship the golden calf, right? So how did those folks live and how did they witness? And insights?
There's a number of words in this to this church that really strike me, and especially the garments that they have. You know, that's what they put on, garments that they put on. And I think Jesus is saying that this church has got two groups of people, people that wear soiled garments, which they themselves have soiled, and people which don't wear soiled garments, obviously. You know, and so I go back to the beginning verse that Jesus says, I know your deeds, that you have a name. You have a name. So I get the impression that this church, there's a group of people, not all of them, but there's a group of people in this church that they view church as having a great name in the community. You know, it's not a dedication to Jesus and trust in him as Savior. It's a trust in their works to have a great name in the community. And they've made a huge mistake there, say. There's a group of people that, in effect, they've left the gospel. And as Pastor Andy was talking about this, I was thinking about the 10 virgins, too. He brought up Matthew, you know, and also I think it's in Matthew, too. Maybe it's Mark, I don't know. But, you know, there's 10 virgins, and five of them had enough oil that when Jesus returned, they were ready to go with him. The other five said, we don't have enough, you know. It's like you have a group of people all together, and they're all virgins. I think that means that they're all, let's say, they've all at one time or another put their faith in the Lord as Savior. But five of them have, let's say, drifted, like Paul would write to the Galatians, you know, why are you going back to the works instead of the grace of God? You know, why are you relying on the works instead of the Spirit? I think this church has made this error here. I think they value having a great reputation in the community more than, and that reputation that I think they're thinking it has some sort of salvation power, and I'm sure it doesn't, of course. And there's the other group of people that they have not done that. They walk, you know, and Jesus says, that group will walk with me in white. And, you know, that brings up the idea of being washed by the blood of Jesus so that we have white garments. So they're still trusting in that. And Jesus says, for they are worthy. The other group is obviously not worthy because they're no longer trusting in his saving blood. You know, so I see a contrast here. They've got people in the church that have made a horrible, let's say, they wear a belief system that is not a system that depends on the Lord, but a system that they have worked to create. So maybe this church's self-effort is the false gospel, let's say, that they're believing, you know. It's interesting because I see, you know, a lot of people take verse 5, the clause in there, I will not erase his name from the book of life. You know, he who overcomes. Well, overcomers are those that finally have given up totally on trying to save themselves in any way, shape, or form and believed in the Lord as their personal savior. And that act of believing, there's other verses indicate that is overcoming, you know. So they have white garments and their name is already in the book of life. And Jesus is saying, once you're in the book of life, you're not going to get it. I'm not going to erase your name from there at all. I will never do it, you know. So I think this, a lot of times people say, well, this is a very discouraging verse because there's a chance you could get your name erased from the book of life, you know. I think this is a positive verse. Jesus is saying, if you've overcome, and you're wearing garments that have been washed, they're white, washed in my blood, you're trusting as I am the Savior and nothing else. Once you've believed in me, you are in the book of life forever.
Amen.
Yeah.
Now, so I think Jim hits it right on the head, and that really, that aspect of the Sardis church is incredibly prevalent in our modern church, that we have a corporate allegiance to the vitality or the name of our church or the congregation that we belong to, instead of having that type of allegiance to Christ himself. We have traded koinonia, fellowship with Christ, for fellowship among one another. And that's what the modern church teaches, fellowship among one another. But that only can be sustained if we have initially fellowship with Christ. I want to look at this. Go to 1 Corinthians 11. 1 Corinthians 11, 17 through 19. And I think it also answers the question that Neil was speaking about how this happens in a church. And I want to show you, just like it does in Matthew, there are always wheat and tares. There's always going to be some kind of division in a church. Look at, again, 1 Corinthians 11, 17 through 19. But in the following instructions, I do not commend you, because when you come together, it is not for the better, but for the worse. For in the first place, when you come together as a church, I hear that there are divisions among you, and I believe it in part. For there must be factions among you in order that those who are genuine among you can be recognized. Neil, that is how the two groups can coexist. In a church, there always has to be factions. There has to be a contrast to show who who's genuine. So there has to be people with stained clothes so that those who have not soiled their clothes can be recognized as being genuine Christians and can draw those others through that contrast to come over. Remember, when you have a church, you have a congregation and a church, and your goal is every single week to bring people from the larger congregation to join the Church of Jesus Christ. They're all there, but they're all not in the church.
Amen.
Amen. And the church is the people. That's awesome.
But you got to get them out of the congregation into the church.
Yeah.
But they're coming for all different reasons. They don't have nothing to do with Jesus.
Yeah.
Amen. Anybody want the last word and pray us out? Oh, go ahead.
Jim has something to say.
I just wondered, this is really not so much on the Church of Sardis, but this section that Pastor Andy brought up here has got a lot of powerful teaching on the communion as you read further on. I mean, you know, Paul makes this statement, you know, for this reason, that is the reason that they are not discerning that they are partaking of the bread and the cup of Jesus, you know, his own sacrifice. For this reason, many among you are weak and sick, and a number sleep, die even. You know, that's almost frightening to say that Paul's writing to that church. You know, they're getting together and they got factions among them, and they changed the communion into like a meal of some sort of celebration that was all just very fleshly based, not recognizing they're partaking with something very, very sovereign and very sacred and so forth. And Paul says, for that reason, you are weak and sick and a number sleep.
I like to read James chapter 5, verse 19 and 20. My brothers, if any one of you should wander from the truth, someone should bring him back. Remember this, whoever turns a sinner from the error of his way will save him from death and cover over a multitude of sins.
Amen, amen.
Awesome last word. Holly, would you follow that up by praying us out?
Sure. Father in heaven, we're in your hands. Sometimes we don't know our right hand from our left, but you're guiding us. We just want to be guided by your Holy Spirit. Be true in our hearts to you always. We want to escape the world and its lust and rejoice in you, bring others into the kingdom. So let's go forth rejoicing in your name. Amen.
Praise God.
Amen.
God bless. God, have a great day.
Andy, we'll see you next week in Indiana.
Yes.
All righty.
Get back there. I'm leaving. Jesus. I'm leaving tomorrow at 6. I'm preaching at North Baptist on Sunday.
Oh, Northside Baptist, right?
Northside Baptist, yes. On Sunday.
Excellent. So, all right. Well, as always, y'all can hang out in the parking lot. I'll stop the recording.